The Trinity. That's a tough one, isn't it? The Trinity's kind of a, you know, it's, the Trinity's an interesting topic because it's so formational to the beginning of the church, yet it's so mysterious to most Christians today.
What chapter was it?
2 Corinthians chapter 13, very last page of 2 Corinthians. So I think that it's interesting that we've lost some of the importance that the church today, I don't think that the church says that the Trinity isn't important, but I think that in the way we live and in the way we study, we see the Trinity as kind of this peripheral dogma, this kind of theological thing that some people need to learn, but it's not necessarily all that important for me as a Christian in my day-to-day life, right? Give me Jesus and I'll be fine. That's exactly backwards. And I'll show you why I say that. Patheos is a website that has many different faiths represented. They don't necessarily, they're not a specifically Christian website. They have a Christian channel, but they have even an atheist guy writing at Patheos. There's a lot of different faith traditions represented there. And in the Progressive Christian Channel, Pastor Mark Sandlin, who is a pastor of the Presbyterian Church USA, wrote an article entitled, No Trinity for Me, Please. And this is actually what he said, and I'm going to quote from his article. He says, admittedly, the Trinity is an interesting theory, and it certainly quelled some of the early church's division on the nature of God, but it is just that, a theory. Now, I'm not saying that the theory of the Trinity is wrong. I'm just not saying that it's definitively right, which is exactly what many of its adherents do when they say that, if you don't believe in the Trinity, you can't be a Christian. Here's the thing. If the Trinity is that important, doesn't it seem like Jesus or the book of Acts or Paul or James or Peter or John would have talked more directly about it? The lack of biblical witness leads me to believe that either there were simply no understanding of a Trinitarian God at the time the books of the Bible were written, or that the concept was so unimportant to their faith that it mostly wasn't mentioned. So why do we make it important? Now, this is a pastor who's writing this, and you guys are listening intently, but if I would have read that, say, in 400 AD, they would have been aghast. They would have been standing on their chairs right now. They would have been, oh, I can't believe a pastor in the Christian church would have said that. And that's the difference. And I find that fascinating. Now, let me read to you 2 Corinthians 13, starting in verse 5. Paul is warning the church of Corinth that they need to be careful and make sure they know what they believe. And he says in verse 5, test yourselves to see if you are in the faith. Examine yourselves, or do you yourselves not recognize that Jesus Christ is in you, unless you fail the test? And I hope you will recognize that we do not fail the test. Now we pray to God that you do nothing wrong, not that we may appear to pass the test, but that you may do what is right, even though we may appear to fail. He's basically telling them, you know, even if it looks like we're goofing, I'd rather us fail than you guys. For we are not able to do anything against the truth, but only for the truth. In fact, we rejoice when we are weak and you are strong. We also pray that you become fully mature. This is why I'm writing these things while absent, that when I am there, I will not use severity. He doesn't want to have to chastise them for not making sure they are in the faith. They're not making sure that they're believing the wrong things. In keeping with the authority the Lord gave me for building up and not for tearing down. Finally, brothers, rejoice, become mature, be encouraged, be of the same mind, be at peace, and the God of love and peace will be with you. Greet one another with a holy kiss. All the saints greet you. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Paul closes this section and closes his letter with an appeal to the Trinity, right? The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. He appeals to all three members of the Trinity as saying, that's how you become mature. okay? This is one aspect of true belief. And a matter of fact, this is what the Christian church did. How do you find out if you're a true Christian? Well, you got to make sure that you believe the right things. The Trinity is an essential aspect of Christianity because it is central to what makes Christianity unique. Just like anything else, if I were to ask, my son is a hockey player, okay? Now, I know, I mean, I watch hockey. I love hockey. Big hockey fan. Have to be. Last name's Esposito. I can't get up. And I know all the positions. I know all the rules. I know how to hold the stick. Matter of fact, we go back out there and pass pucks sometimes in the backyard. And I have all of the knowledge. I have all of the, I can talk the talk. Got all the verbiage down. But I wouldn't necessarily call myself a hockey player because there's a distinguishing feature, right? How do you know a person's a hockey player? If they are playing a game of hockey, if they're in some kind of a league or if they're, right? There's certain essentials. There's a necessary condition that must be met in order to be considered a hockey player. Knowing about it, talking about it, and even goofing around is not necessarily the same thing as being a hockey player. When we talk about being a Christian, what are the necessary attributes in being a Christian? Well, the necessary attributes were talked about and actually discussed very vehemently in the first few centuries of the church, culminating, well, at least officially beginning in 325 at the Council of Nicaea, where the church came up with this kind of this formula which evolved into what you would now know as the Apostles' Creed. But the idea that God is a triune being. And there were several councils after this to kind of refine what that means. But they at least established the idea that you have to believe in one God existing in three persons, that Jesus is both God and man, that there is a union of Godhood and manhood within him, but there is still only one God. These are the essentials. Because the message of Christianity is not that a man did something for us before God, but that God himself humbled himself and became man. Right? So, Philippians 2. Though Christ did not see it as equality with God, something to be grasped, he humbled himself, took on the form of a servant, even unto death. And that's the message, that's the gospel is wrapped in the idea that God would be a being who could, in the second person of the Trinity, offer himself on our behalf. The Trinity is necessary for understanding the total sacrifice of Christ for our sins. Matter of fact, Romans 5, in another book, Paul makes it very, very clear when he says, "For one will scarcely die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person one would even dare to die. But God shows his love for us that while we were sinners, Christ died for us." God shows his love for us. Now think the Father shows his love for us that while we were sinners, Christ died for us. If Christ is not God, how does the Father show his love for us in Christ's death? "Since therefore we have now been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God. For what if, while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his Son, so much more now that we are reconciled shall we be saved by his life." Notice this. By the death of his Son, Paul makes a very clear statement. It is the Son of God who pays for our sins. Maybe you could do a one-to-one. Maybe a good man would die for a bad man, although that's hard to, you know, get somebody to sign off on that. But Jesus, while we were yet sinners, while we were enemies with God, God sent his Son. Now, here's one of the interesting things about this. It really, when you deny the Trinity, you reduce the sacrifice made for our sins. What do I mean by that? If Jesus was the one sacrificing himself for our sins, and that is true, he did that. But if that's all he was another being sacrificing himself on our behalf, well, that's a sacrifice that he makes. But what would you rather do? Anybody who has kids here, tell me, which is harder, giving up your life for another or giving up the life of your child for another? which is the harder sacrifice to make? If Jesus is not the Son of God, then the sacrifice of God the Father is not shown through in this exchange, if you will. It's interesting that I think when you start denying the Trinity, you reduce the actual commitment of Christ. First of all, the fact that he would humble himself, as I had said, that's a sacrifice in and of itself, because, by the way, it's a one-way street. And people don't realize that. When Jesus became a man, he became a man forever. You never get to go. Now, he is glorified, right? Because he humbled himself, God the Father raises him up and tells every knee to bow. But he will never not be a man again. He will always have his humanity. He's raised as the first fruits of all of us who will be raised from the dead. So he will always be human, and he will always be limited in some sense in that regard. So the Trinity is key to Christian theology because it's key to the atonement. It's key to the salvific act. Yes, you can maybe get a one-to-one, but who can pay for the sins of all humanity? No one other than God himself. That's the value exchange, right? It's like swapping money at the airport when you travel abroad. You can't get more than you are worth. And if you're just one being, one human being swapping for another human being, that doesn't make any sense. So Jesus has to be more than merely a human being. He has to be more than a man. He has to be the God-man. Now, JWs, Jehovah's Witnesses, Mormons, all those others will deny this essential fact of the Trinity. And this is the piece that separates us from them. This is a big deal, that if you deny the Trinity, you are basically denying Christianity, because Christianity is centrally located in the Trinity. And that's the key. So that's where we're going tonight. Now, first, before we go too far, we better describe exactly what I mean when I say the Trinity, because a lot of people try to get their heads around it, and it's a tough topic. If I were to ask anyone here to describe the Trinity, how many of you would want to venture a guess or venture an explanation? Okay, a couple of you. Well, good, good. Because it's a tough thing to say, right? It's tough. Now, how many of you can actually show me from the Bible why we believe in the Trinity? That's even harder. Yeah, you can imagine. So, well, let me tease out the concept of the Trinity first. First of all, first and foremost, Christianity is a monotheistic faith. We believe in one God, okay? Christians believe that there is only one being known as God, just one. So Judaism is highlighted as the religion, the first faith that establishes this great monotheistic tradition. The Shema, Deuteronomy 6:4, is the most famous line. This is from the book of Moses, Deuteronomy, where he writes, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one," right? Shema Israel, Elohim Adokhenu, Elohim Echad. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one being, not in a culture that had tons of polytheism. God's everywhere. You can, go to the God supermarket, pick whatever God you want. Israel says, no, that's wrong. There's only one God. So they cut a distinctive cloth. Exodus 20, then, you have the Lord God telling Israel, you shall have no false gods before me, right? Rule out all the other gods because they don't count. There are no demigods. There are no separate gods. There's only one God. And even in the New Testament, we see Paul saying the same thing again. In 1 Corinthians 8:6, he writes, quote, "Yet for us there is but one God, the Father from whom are all things, and we exist for him, and one Lord Jesus Christ, by whom are all things, and we exist through him." So the same kind of formula of existing for and through Paul uses, but he definitely affirms that there is one being called God. However, unlike Judaism, we would say that there are three persons within that one God. Now, here's the way it gets a little hard to understand. But follow me here for a minute, and I'll I'll hopefully explain it well. First of all, we know that God the Father is God. The Bible clearly shows that God the Father is God, right? I don't think anybody has any hard objections to that. Nobody I've ever met has run into, well, the Father's not really God. They may say that he wasn't God for all time, and we'll get to that. That has problems in and of itself. But God the Father is God. That's pretty much, when we talk about God, people think of, you know, that kind of a concept. But when we look at the life of Christ and what he said and what he did, we find out that Jesus seems to show the attributes of God as well. First of all, the scriptures call Jesus God. John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us, it says in John 1:12, so we know that it's talking about Jesus. But in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. Now, it sounds like double talk, but maybe if you put different names in there. In the beginning was Jesus, and Jesus was with the Father, and he was God. And the same was in the beginning with the Spirit, maybe. You have God in there three times. He's called God in John 20:28 when Thomas sees him, right? Stick your hands in my side, remember? Thomas falls down. What does he say? My Lord and my God. Now, if Jesus is a great teacher, Son of God, but not God himself, what's the first thing he's going to do? He's going to rebuke Thomas. He rebuked Peter. Remember when Peter just said, Lord, don't go to Jerusalem. And Jesus turned around and snapped at him and said, get thee behind me, Satan. He rebuked Peter right away. How come he didn't rebuke Thomas for what would be, in a Jewish mind, an even worse sin of calling him God, unless he was recognizing the godhood that Jesus actually showed? And in 2 Peter 1:1, he's called God. By the righteousness of our God and Savior, Jesus Christ, is the way Peter writes that verse. So he's called God. The scriptures show that he's involved with all the things that only God can do. Okay, Jesus does the things that only God can do. He is involved with creation, John 1:3 and Colossians 1:16 specifically. Jesus is the one who's creating. Jesus can forgive sins. Matthew 19, where they lower the guy from the right, and he says, your sins are forgiven. And all the Pharisees are like, oh, how can you do that? That's blasphemy. And Jesus says, in order so that you know I can forgive sins, take up your bed and walk. You can only forgive someone a debt if that debt is against you. You can't forgive someone a debt. You know, you can't say, oh, that's okay, write it off, if like they owe the government money, okay? You know, if you have an IRS tax bill, I'm going to tell you right now, forget about it. How far do you think that's going to go? Not very far. I actually wrote the IRS and told them, you know, no, I have a receipt. I mailed it to Lois Lerner, and it was in her email. And the fact that you guys can't find them, I don't know. They didn't like that. They didn't buy that. For some reason. I don't know. Anyway, no, you can only forgive a debt that's held against yourself. That you can forgive. That's an actual forgiveness. So if Jesus is forgiving sin, see, we only sin against God, right? Even David said that. Even though he killed Uriah the Hittite and slept with Bathsheba, he said, it is against you and you alone, O Lord, that I have sinned. Sins, we violate God's law. That's what a sin is a violation of God's law. So if Jesus is forgiving sins, he's putting himself in the spot of God. And of course, the resurrection. God the Father raised Jesus from the dead, and by God's Spirit he was raised. But Jesus said he raised himself as well. Matter of fact, John chapter 2, if you remember, the Pharisees were asking, first of all, the disciples were talking about this temple and this and that. He's walking by. And the Pharisees were, you know, by what authority do you do all these miracles? And Jesus says, tear down this temple and in 3 days I will rebuild it. And it took us 46 years to build the thing. And it wasn't even done by the time he was walking by. How can you rebuild it in 3 days? John says he was speaking of the temple of his body. Who's going to rebuild it in 3 days? He's going to raise himself up. Only God has the power of life and death. So he's involved in all the things that God does. He's called God, and he receives worship. We talked about John 20:28, where Thomas falls down and worship him. But Hebrews 1:6 says that God the Father commands all of the angels to worship God the Son. But of the Son, he says, Hebrews 1:6, that all of the angels fall down and worship him. Now, God the Father would never do that to any created being, because worship is reserved for God alone. Jesus said it in Matthew 4. Remember, the devil took him out to the mountain, to the desert, was tempting him. And Jesus quoted straight from Deuteronomy. You know, I'll give you all these kingdoms if you fall down and worship me. And Jesus says, no, for it is written, God alone is the one we must worship. Matter of fact, in Revelation 19, John's been taking on a tour of the new temple and all this stuff, and he's looking around. He's so caught up in it, he's so overwhelmed, that he falls down at the feet of the angel who is taking him on this tour. And the angel says, no, don't do that. Why not? Because I am a created being like yourself. The angel says, because I'm created, I'm not worthy of that worship. Worship God. So between Matthew 4 and Revelation 19, we know that only worship is only reserved for God alone. Yet God the Father tells the angels to worship Jesus. And Jesus claimed it. You know, people say he never claimed to be God. Well, he did. John 8:58, Jesus claimed a timelessness. Before Abraham was born, I am. And that word, I am, echoes back to Exodus 3, where Moses said, you know, who should I say this burning bush is to tell the children of Israel? And he says, I am that I am. That's where we get the idea of the Yahweh, the tetragrammaton, that four. It means the becoming one. It means the one who is, the I am sent you. And so when Jesus says, I am, he is making a definitive statement of being God. He makes another one in where he quotes the book of Daniel, saying that he is the Son of Man coming on the clouds to judge the living and the dead. And that's when the high priests in the trial say, we don't even need witnesses. He just blasphemed. We can stone him. So he makes these claims to being divine. There's a great book, if you really want to get more into this idea of Jesus and the proof texts that show how he is God. And it's a book by Rob Bowman and Ed Komoszewski called Putting Jesus in His Place, The Case for the Deity of Christ. The bookstore has them. I made sure the bookstore had two different kinds of books tonight. One is Putting Jesus in Its Place. Phenomenal book. If you ever have Jehovah's Witnesses come to your door, this is the book you have to have. And they use what they call the HANDS acronym. Jesus holds all the honors, receives all the honors of God. He does all the attributes of God. He has all the names of God. He's called all the names. He does the deeds of God, and he sits on God's throne. That's the HANDS argument. I've done a class on this, actually. If you want to find that, you can do that as well. So I don't want to spend too much time on it. But that's a great, by the way, the other good book that I'm going to highly recommend if you want to understand the Trinity and how it relates to Christianity is The Deep Things of God by Fred Sanders. There are 5 copies of that in the bookstore as well. Phenomenal book. Fred Sanders, theology professor over at Biola University, talks about how central to Christianity the Trinity is and why we need to recapture that concept. Okay, so God the Father is God, Jesus is God, but the Holy Spirit is God as well. Now, what about this Holy Spirit? Well, the Spirit of God is not mentioned as much, perhaps, in certain senses. We know that he's another person because Jesus tells us that in John 14. When I go away from you, I will send another, a comforter. So it's not me. It's not me wearing a mask. It's another being, a comforter, to help you, the paraclete. Holy Spirit is called God in Acts chapter 5. There's this little tithing issue in the early church. I don't know if you guys remember. A couple named Ananias and Sapphira thought that they could look better than they actually were. So they said they sold off all their property, and there wasn't any problem with them keeping some of their property back. They didn't have to do this. But they were, in order to be seen by men, trying to make pretense as that they gave up everything they had when they really didn't. And Peter says, why are you lying to the Holy Spirit? That's the way he says it. You are not lying to men, but to God. So right there, Peter says the Holy Spirit is God. You're lying to the Spirit, you're lying to God. Well, couldn't that be God's active force? Well, no, you don't lie to an active force, right? Anybody lied to gravity lately? Or grieved gravity. By the way, you can grieve the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit has the same attributes of God. Holy Spirit has omniscience. 1 Corinthians chapter 2 says, "For to us God revealed them through the Spirit. For the Spirit searches all things, even the depths of God. For who among men knows the thoughts of a man except the spirit of man which is in him? Even so the thoughts of God no one knows except the Spirit of God." So the Spirit here is shown to be omniscient. If you know all the thoughts of God, then you know all there is to know. He has omnipresence, right? Psalm 139, "Where can I flee from your Spirit? If I go to the ends of the earth, you are there. If I go to the depths of Sheol, you are there." So the Spirit is everywhere. And he does the deeds of God as well. The Spirit is also involved in creation. Genesis 1, 2, the Spirit brooded over the face of the deep. And the resurrection. Romans 8, 11 says, "But the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you. He who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you." So there the Holy Spirit's involved in. So you see creation, resurrection, the Father, Son, and Spirit are all involved in all of it. You see the Trinity over and over again. In any of the major acts, any of the major events that happen in the Bible, all three members of the Trinity are involved. So we know that we believe in one God. We know that God the Father is called God. Jesus, God the Son, is called God. And the Holy Spirit is called God. We know God the Father has the attributes of God. Jesus has the attributes of God. The Spirit has the attributes of God. God the Father does the deeds of God. Jesus does the deeds of God. The Spirit does the deeds of God. Right? So how does this work then? How can you have one being and these three together making up this one being? Now, there's not a lot of analogies that people try to use. They'll talk about eggs with the yolk and the shell and the white. Or they'll talk about maybe a triangle, three sides of a triangle, you know, without all three sides. The problem with all of those analogies is not only do they break down, they actually don't work at all because they develop into a heresy. God can't be separated like an egg. See, an egg can be separated. You can put the white over here. You can put the yolk over here. You can put the shell over here. Now, each of those things is not an egg. Really, an egg is all three of those things together. So it's not that if you separate Jesus that he's not God by himself. That's not true. Jesus is holy God and holy man. Or that you can pull them apart and tease them in that regard. That doesn't work that way. And this is the problem with water or you know, an actor or a husband. All this kind of stuff. You get some confusion when you start to use analogies. Augustine took the idea of God is love, and he kind of came a little closer, I guess, when he said, God is, if you think about the idea of God being love, you need at least three things for love. You need the lover, right? That's the guy who's in love. You need the beloved, that's the thing that the lover loves, whatever that, maybe his wife, maybe chocolate. In and out, right? How do these people on the East Coast do it? So it's the lover, the beloved, and the love that exists between them. Now, obviously, I'm having a little fun. Augustine was talking about a relational experience with two entities. That love, there is a real tangible thing called love that exists between two people who love one another. So that was Augustine's attempt. And that's not bad. I mean, the love is a separate thing, but you can't have the love unless all three are there at the same time. And that is love. But they all fail. And the reason they all fail is because we're human and God's not. Basically, what it boils down to is we are trying to explain something that is above ourselves. And that's very tricky to do. I don't know if you ever remember geometry class, but when we talk about geometry class, we start with a point, right? And everybody, what's a point? It's just a single point in space, no dimensionality, right there. Okay. Well, what's the next level of dimensionality? Maybe a line, but a line is a single dimension, It's just got width. That's all it's got. So you can talk about the width of a line, and it could be short or small, but that's the only dimensionality it has. It has a single dimension. Two-dimensional figure would be maybe a box, right? You draw a square. Okay, so a square is two-dimensional because it has height as well as width. And then if you take it to the third level, what's a third-dimensional? Well, it's a cube, because now you have height, width, and length. Okay, well, how do you square the cube? What's the fourth-dimensional level? Now it gets tricky for us. Why? Because we don't live in four dimensions. We live in three. It's easy for us to go down, pretty tough for us to go up. What's a fifth-dimensional object? How do you describe that? I don't know. I really don't. Fourth dimension, maybe we could talk about time as the fourth dimension, 3.5. We can only go forward and look back. We can't go back and look forward. So this is the same frustration we get with God. How many dimensions is God? Now what do we do? And see, now to me, this is not a problem. To me, this is a little bit comforting because the way I see it, any God that we can fully wrap our minds around is not a God worthy of our worship. We know from the scripture that this, first of all, that the scripture is reliable. We know Jesus rose from the dead, so we can go from the historical aspects to his authoritative aspects, and that's what he said. I told you, John chapter 2, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it. Why did he say that? Because they asked him for an authority statement. By what authority do you do this? Because I'll prove to you my authority to be speaking on these spiritual issues. It's through my resurrection. So that's the way I say it. I mean, there's other, you know, you can think about maybe a corporation. Say that there's a 3-member board of directors on the corporation. Each corporate member has the full power and legal force of the corporation. So if I sign my name to a document, the corporation is committed legally to perform that task. Or if either of my other two partners sign it, so each one has the full force and an idea of the corporation, yet all three of them together are actually the corporate. I don't know. I don't even know if that works. But there's these ideas. But what you have to remember is God, that being and personhood are actually two different concepts. And it is not a contradiction, and we'll go through this in just a second, to say that there are three persons in the one being of God. Okay, matter of fact, I think I'll probably tease this out now since I've kind of gone to this level. Let me find out where I did that note. Oh, here we are. The doctrine is contradictory. Okay, let's just take that objection. People will say, well, you're trying to make God three and God one at the same time. It doesn't make sense. It's not logical. Okay, well, if I can create an argument to show you why it's logical, would you believe? I would say that Christianity teaches a plurality within God, that by Scripture we can say that the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit can express themselves differently. That's rule number one. The Father, Son, and Holy Spirit can express themselves differently. What do I mean by that? When Jesus prays at the Garden of Gethsemane, I take this cup from me, Lord. Nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. There seems to be a distinction between the Father and Son there, isn't there? When Jesus in John 14 says, when I go, I will send you another. There's some kind of differentiation he's making between himself and the Father and himself and the Son. So all I'm claiming is that there is, and each of those beings, or each of those persons are talked about as a person, okay? Another, not another thing, you know. He said, I will send you another person. He will, using the personal pronoun male. So God the Father is referred to as a person. The Holy Spirit is referred to as a person. Jesus is referred to as a person. So the person of the Father is God, the person of the Son is God, and the person of the Holy Spirit is God. And I've already made that point. Therefore, God is one being comprised from the persons of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. That makes sense to me. If there is one God, and the Father is God, the Son is God, and the Holy Spirit is God, it then follows that God is one being comprised of the Father and the Son and the Spirit. Okay, I've not made any claim. Now, if we are to claim that the Father is a being, the Son is a being, and the Spirit is a being, then we'd have the contradiction. But that's not what Christian doctrine teaches. Personhood, and this is my next section of the argument, personhood is not the same as being if the number of persons of an entity differs from the number of beings present in itself. That's a mouthful. Let me say that again. Let me go real slow here. I'm trying to draw the distinction between being and personhood. Now I can argue that if we can find a case where there is a difference in number between a being and a person, we would then know that personhood is not the same thing as being. Following me? Okay? So my argument is personhood is not the same thing as being if the number of persons in any entity that we can find is different than the number of beings for that same entity within itself. Whew. This sounds harder than it is. Let me give you an example. A plant is an entity. It's a living being. It grows and it reproduces. How many persons are represented in any plant? Absolutely zero, right? So you have a being that's alive, growing. Is a dog a being? Yeah, a dog's a being. Is it sentient? To some, it depends on your dog, actually. Sometimes my dog's more sentient than others. But is a dog a person? Absolutely not. A dog's a dog. So here we have a couple of cases where you have a being, a living entity, with a value of one living entity, but the personhood value of that entity is zero. Then you have a human who has a living entity of one with a personhood value of one, right? So why is it not the case that God could be a living entity, a living being with a personhood value of three? All I'm doing is arguing for the case that there exists in our experience an idea of a living being where the personhood value is different than that being. Now, it's zero, but it's different. Therefore, and remember my statement, personhood is not the same thing as being if the number of persons of any entity is different from the number of beings present in that entity. Therefore, God can be one being comprised of a different number of persons without contradiction. Because a dog is a being comprised of a different number of persons than itself. Therefore, the doctrine of the Trinity is not contradictory. So this is my argument. My argument, if you claim that the Trinity is a contradiction, you got to say, no, personhood is different than being. A plant is a being with zero personhood. I'm a being with one personhood, and God's a being with three personhoods. Now, it's not an analogy. It's an argument. But I'm arguing from the lesser to the greater. And that's about the only way I know how to do it. But the point here is to show that the concept of a Trinity, one being with three persons, is not contradictory. We may not be able to wrap our heads around it, but let's face it, there's a whole lot of things that we have trust in that we can't wrap our heads around. We turn on the television, right? Anybody can explain to me exactly how that works? We trust our modern medicine, an MRI, or we don't know nearly what the doctors know. We know what the results can be. We trust the information that they have, and we rely on it. So it's not unreasonable to trust something that you don't completely understand, as long as it's coherent and it has evidence to back it up. What's the evidence for the Trinity? Well, the resurrection of Jesus, for a start. That's one of the evidences. Okay, so how does this then play against other worldviews? Let's see, I'm doing good in time. First of all, we're going to go from the east, and we're going to work our way west. There. Ty, can you see if that thermostat can be turned down? I think people would very much appreciate it. I don't know if it's adjustable or not, but if you can, knock yourself out. Okay, so let's start with kind of the Far East things, pantheism or panentheism. These are worldviews, you see them in Eastern sects, Buddhism, Hinduism, things like that. There's a specific difference between the two. Pantheism means God is everything. It's all just God. Panentheism means God's spirit kind of exists within everything. It's a subtle nuance, but it's... But basically, they both run into the same problems. Okay? Pantheism and panentheism really don't have strong objections to the Trinity per se. They wouldn't be ones... In other words, you talk to a Hindu, and he wouldn't be one to say, oh, yeah, the three-in-one thing... No, I can't believe that. That's illogical. That's not what they would do. They wouldn't have any problem with that. They holding contrary views in tension is really kind of part and parcel with some of their beliefs. So they don't have it. They don't have a big stumbling block with that. Matter of fact, the problem is they go too far. Either there's a bunch of gods, right, in the 330 million Hindu gods, but those are really all demigods that go back to the primary god, which is. Atman. And so there's a famous saying in Hindu, all Brahman is Atman. All, basically, everything is really God when you put it all together. When you get down right down to it, it's all God. Well, a couple of problems with that. First of all, you have no distinction between creator and creature at that point, which means that God is as much evil as the world is evil, and really kind of functioning just on a mechanical level. Matter of fact, the biggest problem I see within Hinduism is the law of karma, the law of death and rebirth. The idea of karma, see, karma is a cruel taskmaster, and anybody who's studied any of these Eastern philosophies will tell you that it's brutal because, think about it, you are punished. You're born into a family that's very, very rich. They would say, well, you must have lived a very good life in the past so that you've gotten this kind of wealth. Now, if you do something wrong, kill a man or something like that, you get pushed back down, and in your next life, you get born as a beggar or something like that, right? So you are living a life where you are being punished for deeds that you don't remember doing, you have no way to change, and you have no way to escape it in order to get out. Not even God can escape karma. Karma is above all. It's this mechanical, soulless, fierce, retributive system that everybody's caught in. Oh, and by the way, we in the West clean this up a whole lot. Because while you hear these people, well, you know, I went to the psychic and she told me I was, you know, a field maid in King Edward's castle, or, you know, you always know somebody who's famous. You're always like working in the house of something. You're never the famous person yourself, or you're never like, I was just a nobody. I don't know. Nobody cared about me. You know, it's always something with those guys. But in the Eastern mindset, you could come back as a dung beetle. I mean, you're not guaranteed humanity. You could come back as, you know, a paramecium. How'd you like that for your reading? But nobody talks about that. In the West, we like to think that we're going forward. Anyway, that's one of the problems. So because of that, then you get the whole problem of, well, wait a minute, does God set what's good? Or who's determining the law of karma? Who's making those judgments? How do you know? If we can evolve into God, right, we can achieve enlightenment, and become part of that whole thing, then who's the one that sets the law? Who set it up to begin with? Lots of problems with how you understand God at all in Eastern mindsets. So pantheism and panentheism really don't help us in any way, shape, or form because there's nothing to truly appeal to. Now, Islam, that's a different story because Islam holds to, they're a monotheistic faith, and they hold to a single God. Islam has very strong feelings against the Trinity. Matter of fact, the Quran talks about it in several places. In chapter 5, verse 116, the Quran writes, "And behold, Allah will say, quote, O Jesus, son of Mary, did thou say unto men, take me and my mother for the two gods beside Allah? He will say, glory to thee, Jesus speaking now. He will say, glory to thee, never could I say what I had no right to say. Had I said such thing, that would indeed have known it. Thou knowest what's in my heart, know not what is in thine, for thou knowest in full all that is hidden. The key here with Surah 5 is the Muslims, again, Arabia, Christianity hadn't had a really strong theological presence by the time Muhammad was living. They got a lot of Gnostic teachings, a lot of heretical things. And so Muhammad thought the Trinity was God the Father, Mary, and they had the child Jesus. That's literally what this says. O Jesus, the Son of Mary, did thou say unto men, take me and my mother for the two gods beside Allah? So they were thinking three beings. A Trinity means three gods. God the Father, who got married to a mother and had the child Jesus. And that to them was not only ridiculous, but actually blasphemous in their view. When they hear the word that God so gave his only begotten son, the word begetting, they think sex. They think physical relations. And to them, that means that they're equating God with man, and that's the sin of shirk. And you can never, God is something wholly other than humanity. You can never tie him to God. So here's a couple of others. Surah 4, it says, O people of the book, O people of the book is you and me, by the way, Christians and Jews, because they accept that the Old Testament and the New Testament was given by Allah, but it got corrupted somehow through the years. Okay? So, O people of the book, commit no excesses in your religion, nor say to Allah aught but the truth. Christ Jesus, the Son of Mary, was no more than a messenger from Allah, and his word, which he bestowed on Mary, and a spirit proceeding from him. So believe in Allah and his messengers. Say not three. Desist. It will be far better for you, for Allah is one God. Glory be to him. Far exalted is he above having a son. Far exalted is he above. Again, God's better than having a son. To him belong all things in the heavens and on earth, and enough is Allah as disposer of the affairs. And of course, Surah 112, say he is Allah, the one and the only, Allah the eternal, absolute. He begetteth not, nor is he begotten, and there is none like unto him. Another, God doesn't do this kind of stuff. The last one, this is the one that's probably, even though not as familiar, the most grievous, because it is literally written on the Dome of the Rock Mosque that sits on the Temple Mount in Jerusalem. And it's Christian heresy. I mean, it's Islam specifically shooting down Christianity. And Surah 19, verses 33 to 35 says, So peace is upon me the day I was born, and the day I die, and the day I shall be raised alive. Such is Jesus, Son of Mary. It is a statement of truth about which they doubt. It is not befitting to the majesty of Allah that he should beget a son. Glory be to him. When he determines a matter, he only says it to it be, and it is. So there you go. There's again, the idea of God begetting. Part of the problem is that they don't understand the idea of begotten without sexual union. Part of the problem is that Islam doesn't believe that man is inherently sinful. They believe that you're born basically at zero. And you can go down and you can go up and you can go down and you can go up. Your good deeds hopefully outweigh your bad and things like that. But God would never humble himself to become a man in Islam. It doesn't make sense to them. Now, what's the problem with that? Well, first of all, they're quoting Jesus as Son of Mary. Where are they getting that information from? How do they know that Jesus was Mary's son? Why do they call us people of the book? Because they're pulling it from the New Testament accounts. So you can't accept the New Testament and not accept all of the things that the New Testament says. Because who makes you the arbiter? Why should you know what's right and what's wrong? You know, we have separate accounts. And again, here's the point. So the peace is upon me on that day I was born and the day I die and the day I shall be raised alive. Well, that's curious. Jesus is raised. So you have an affirmation of a raising. At the same time, you have a denial of the Trinity. The two things don't work together. So Islam fails in the sense that they try to separate the Trinity from who Jesus was when Jesus' central claim was, destroy this temple and I'll rebuild it in 3 days. I'll prove that I'm the Son of God. I'll prove that I can forgive sins. To say that Jesus forgave sins would be tantamount to shirk as well, would be putting a man in God's place. So Islam fails in that regard. Now Judaism is usually when I talk with my Jewish friends, I've found a couple of things. First of all, have you ever wished you could just get a whole bunch of Jewish people together? Maybe, you know how these debates happen? You ever see these Christian debates, like William Lane Craig or somebody will come out and they'll fill up a room with 700? That's not a new thing. They've been doing this a long time. They did one in 1263 AD, where they got a whole bunch of Christians and a whole bunch of Jews together, and they were going to have a debate on the Trinity. They're going to have a debate on Jesus as Messiah, right? It's called the Disputation of Barcelona. It happened in July of 1263. And it had starred, one of the stars was a very famous Jewish rabbi called Nachmanides. And he was going against a guy, a friar named Paul, on the messiahship of Christ. And Paul claimed, Friar Paul says, he points to Isaiah chapter 53. And he says, you know, look, it's the death of the Messiah right here. You can read it, right? We're man of sorrows. By his stripes we are healed. We're all familiar with Isaiah 53. It shows the death of the Messiah, how he is to fall into the hands of his enemy, and how he's placed among the wicked. And it just happened to Jesus. Don't you believe that this section speaks of the Messiah? And Nachmanides said, in terms of the true meaning of the section, it speaks only of the people of Israel, which the prophets regularly call Israel my servant or Jacob my servant. And that's one of the two ways I've always heard Jews escape these passages. That Isaiah 53 wasn't talking about a person, it was talking about a nation. It was symbolic. They symbolize it. They allegorize it. They turn it into something that says it's not real, a reflection of an individual. It's the suffering that the nation of Israel has gone through. And that's what I hear. So I hear two things. I hear that those aspects that you would talk about which reflect to the Trinity are symbolic of Israel, or that the Christian idea of the Trinity contradicts one of the most basic tenets of Judaism, that God is one. And this comes from the Jewish Encyclopedia. The Jews have declared their belief in a single unified God twice daily ever since the giving of the Torah at Sinai, almost 2,000 years before Christianity. The Trinity suggests a three-part deity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And they go on, they say, that's considered idolatry. You're making three gods. Well, first of all, we're not making three gods. They misunderstand the concept of the Trinity if they believe that. It's not a three-part God. It's each person of the Trinity is holy God. That one being is reflected as three people, or is understood, I should say, as three people. Now, as their justification, they say God, the Torah teaches us that God can't take any form. And they use Exodus 33. You will not be able to see my face, for no human can see my face and live. Remember that story? Moses had to hide in the rock, and God said, I'll cover you. Can't see my face, but you'll be able to see my Shekinah as I pass by. You'll be able to see, kind of catch the last glimpses of me. So God can't take on a form, because this says no one is able to see my face and live. Now, is that what that means? It seems to me that somebody's implying more maybe than the text says, because all we got to do is turn back a few more pages and go to Genesis. And there was a guy named Jacob who received the name Israel, where the nation comes from. How did he receive the name Israel? Because he was wrestling all night, remember? And at the end of his wrestling match, what did he say? I'm going to call this place Peniel, because I have seen the face of God and I live. So, what do you do with Genesis 32 if Exodus 33 says you can never do that? Somebody's wrong somewhere. One of the two has a problem. In other words, if you're using the same exegesis, if you're using the same interpretation of the face of God in Exodus 33 to mean that nobody can see the face of God, then you got to apply it to Genesis 32 as well. It's got to work consistently. Otherwise, there may be an opportunity to say, maybe Exodus 33 doesn't mean what you guys think it means. Maybe it's seeing God in his glory. Doesn't mean that God can't take on any form. It never says that. So Israel did see God's face. But ultimately, when I talk with Jews, you know what? I tend to fall back on the people who know this best, and I fall back on what Jesus did. Jesus had the best answer to the Jews. Pharisees in Matthew 22 were gathered together, and they've been questioning Jesus. I don't know if you remember Matthew 22. The Pharisees would come in and they'd shoot off something, and the Sadducees would come in and they'd shoot off something. And the Pharisees would come in, they were trying to catch Jesus up. Boy, what if this lady's husbands all die? All this stuff, right? And Jesus says, okay, I've taken your test. Now I've got a question to ask you guys. And he says in Matthew 22, verse 42, what do you think about the Christ? Whose son is he? So what's he asking about? He's asking about the divinity of Christ. You know, where does Jesus come from? Where does the Messiah come from? The Jews saw Christ as a human being. Son of David, they said. He said to them, then how then is David in the Spirit calling him Lord, saying, quote, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I put your enemies under your feet. If David calls him Lord, how is he David's son? And everybody went, I have no answer to that. That's literally what they did. Because there is no way the Messiah could be lording over David if he's, first of all, generations from being born. Secondly, only human. In that culture, the father always outranks the son. And the grandfather always outranks both of them. And the great-grandfather, and so on and so on. Your patriarchs are positionally above you. So David would never call Lord his son, because his son would never outrank him. And that's the question that Jesus had said. He goes, the Messiah has to be more than the son of David in order to make this work. And he basically silenced the Jews with that question. I think that's fascinating. I have not had an opportunity to talk with a Jewish friend about it. Usually most Jews are so, most folks of Jewish descent don't even have the concept that Jesus is the son of David. They don't realize that. By the way, the concept of a Trinity does show up in some archaic Jewish writings like the Kabbalah. There's some Kabbalistic writings that actually have their origin right about the time of Jesus and his apostles, that God is three. Now, I don't want to make too big a deal about this, because a lot of people discount those Kabbalic writings as you know, they recognize them that coming from Jews, they just don't recognize them as authoritative. They claim to be given to a guide by the Spirit of God. That's not my point, whether they're authoritative or not. My point is that Jews in the first century AD at least had some inclination of God as being three, because these Kabbalistic writings reflect that. And they're known for that. So it's not like this is something that was invented out of whole cloth by the Christians. It had existed prior to Christianity in some sense. They were just trying to figure it all out. Okay. And quickly, now let's move on from the East and go to the West. Now, the West is dominated right now by Christianity. The Roman Empire and then the Holy Roman Empire allows that to spread. But we do have several folks that you would probably run into more than not today that would hold to arguments against the Trinity. So first of all, we look at Mormonism. Mormonism holds that the Father, God, Jesus, and the Spirit are all different beings. They are not the same being. They're not only different persons, but they're different beings. They believe that the Father's actual name is Elohim. He begat his Spirit Son, Jesus, by a heavenly mother. And in order for Jesus to be incarnated, he came down and actually did have physical relations with Mary in order to conceive Jesus. They also believe, of course, Elohim was once a man and he was exalted to godhood status. So how do you answer this view of Mormonism that there are three gods? Well, you can point to the Bible, Isaiah 43, verses 10 and 11. Also Isaiah 44, 8. It's really clear. Is there any God beside me? Yea, there is no God. I know not any. I use the King James because that's the preferred version within Mormonism. Is there any God beside me? Yea, there is no God. I know not any. There are no other gods beside me, is what he's saying. Are there any gods? I don't know of even one. So the idea that there can be these gods progressing doesn't make sense. Beyond that, God is not immutable. If God was once a man, it's funny, the Mormon, even in Moroni 8:18, which is a Mormon scripture, they quote the verse, we believe in one God, the same yesterday, today, and forever. No, you don't. Look, if we talked about all those attributes of God, okay, omnipotence, omnipresence, right, omnibenevolence, all that stuff. All those things that God is, we're not. I'm not omnipotent. I'm not omnipresent. Definitely not, right? I'm not all-knowing. Definitely not. So, all-powerful, yeah. I'm none of those things. Okay. I'm a man. I don't know of any man that's any of those things, but God is those things. That means that at one point, if God was once a man, he wasn't all of those things as well. So God isn't the same yesterday, today, and forever. He has changed. Matter of fact, every aspect of God, God has taken on at some point in his life because he's had to progress to godhood. So it doesn't make sense. By the way, you get a problem of infinite regress as well. Right? It's like, well, okay, if that God was once a man, who created him? Well, his spirit father. Well, who created him? His spirit father. Well, who created him? His spirit. Well, where does it stop? Now it's not an explanation anymore. It's a regret. You're going to keep going back through infinity. And anytime you have to appeal to infinity, it never started, and you have the problem of an infinite regress. So the Mormon view, that the idea that there are these multiple gods and the God, the Father, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit. By the way, that's the other thing that's bothered me. Has anybody ever been bothered by the Mormon concept of the Holy Spirit? Okay, I get the idea, because Mormons are all big into family, right? And the reason why you get blessed in the temple was so that you and your wife can achieve exaltation. You can sit in the celestial kingdom, and maybe you'll have a planet that you'll rule over as God, and you'll create spirit children who will then worship you and ultimately... Yeah, okay, I get that. And you'll be forever with your family. So God the Father and Jesus, his son, wants to be forever with his family, although he's still ruling his own planet. I would imagine it's going to start getting crowded. You have to be with your father, but not. Maybe they just come over for weekends for visits. I'm not sure. But leaving all of that aside, where does the Holy Spirit fit in? Who's this third wheel? You know, if the family structure is the framework of how godhood works, who's this other guy? I don't understand where he fits in, and I've not got a good answer to that in Mormon theology. So it's just an interesting thing. So Mormons believe in a plurality of gods, but that simply doesn't work. Jehovah's Witnesses, on the other hand, would deny that Jesus is God. They would think that he's a special creation of God, but he's not God himself. Matter of fact, the Jehovah's draw upon the idea that Jesus is Michael the Archangel through some dubious use of the book of Daniel and other places. Now, what they would tell me and what they have told me is that, look, the doctrine of the Trinity doesn't make sense. It's too confusing to be true. And like I said, we can understand God's triunity, or we can apprehend it even if we can't fully comprehend it. And God tells us that my ways are above your ways. My thoughts are above your thoughts. As high as the heaven is from the earth, so are my ways above your ways. and usually they come back with, well, you know, it's a pagan idea. It's like one God with three heads. You ever seen those old monster movies where they use the claymation, right? And you've got the dinosaur or the dragon that has kind of three heads on it. This is what you're talking about. I said, no, that's not. We know that God is eternal. For example, do you believe that God is eternal? Yes. Only God is eternal, right? If Jesus is created, that means he had a beginning. He had a starting point at something. Yes. Well, the Father is called eternal in Psalm 90, verse 2. Jesus is called eternal in John 1:1 and John 1:2, as well as John 8:58, that whole before Abraham was, I am. And the Spirit is called eternal in Hebrews 9:14. And of course, Jesus receives worship in Hebrews 1:6. I usually take them to the Matthew 4 and the Revelation 19 passages, and then I lay on them Hebrews 1:6. And many Jehovah's Witnesses have never heard that before because they're stunned that the Son... Now, in the latest versions of the New World Translation, they've changed the word. In the early versions, if you get 1963 and before, and I have one of those, it says, let all of the angels of God worship him. In the newer versions, it says, let all of the angels of God do obeisance to him. You know, like bow down before a king. The problem is the Greek word is the exact same when the angel says worship God, when Jesus says you shall worship no one than God, and you go to Hebrews 1:6, same Greek word. There's no reason to change that. And the Jehovah's Witnesses didn't change it until they started bumping their heads on this verse. So you hear that kind of thing. What you would just have to say is, look, Jesus is called eternal. And I always use John 1:3. I never argue, because John 1:1, Jesus was a God, not the God. You can point to John 17, I guess. One of the favorite verses of Jehovah's Witnesses is, you know, thou wast the only true God and Jesus Christ whom you have sent, right? Command is to worship you, the only true God and Jesus Christ whom you have sent. So then I go back to John 1:1. Well, if Jesus is a God, does that make him a true God or a false God? Because if he's the true God, then yeah, you should worship him. If he's a false God, you guys got bigger problems now. It doesn't work the other way. So there's problems like that. In John 1:3, Jesus, it says that Jesus created everything that there was ever to be created. And there was not one thing that was created that he did not make. So you got a bucket of stuff. There's two buckets. There's only two things that this could be. You can either be a created thing, something that has a beginning, or you can be eternal, right? There's no third thing. You either had a beginning or you didn't, right? It's like being halfway pregnant. You can't. You're either pregnant or you're not. You're created or uncreated. It says Jesus put everything in the created bucket that was ever created. And there wasn't one thing put in the created bucket that he didn't create. Well, where does that put Jesus? In the uncreated bucket. We've got a word for that. That's called God. That's eternal. So John 1:3, I think, is a clearer argument than John 1:1. You don't have to worry about obscure rules of Greek grammar with it and stuff like that. But the Trinity, the word isn't even in the Bible. Right? Any of you heard this? The word Trinity cannot be found in the Bible. Yeah, and when we try to explain a lot of things, they're not found in the Bible. Guess what else isn't found in the Bible? Theophany. That's a word that people use that it's not found in the Bible. Here's another one. Here's a favorite word the Jehovah's Witnesses use. Theocracy. The idea that God will rule over all. Theocracy is all over witness literature, yet the word is never found in the Bible. Should you stop using it? Or is it merely a word to express an idea in order to make it easier? You know what else isn't a word not found in the Bible? Bible. The word Bible isn't in the Bible. So what does that prove? It proves nothing. It's a false complaint. And then you say, so what we need to do is we need to look at the descriptions of God found in the Bible. Lastly, because I need to wrap up, oneness and modalism. These hold that Jesus is God, but only in the sense that there is one being called God who chooses to manifest himself to his people in different ways. So ancient Israel, he manifested himself as God the Father. In his earthly ministry, he shows up as Jesus, kind of puts on the Jesus facade, the Jesus cloak, if you will. And then now he shows up as the Spirit. So it's kind of like one God taking on three different roles or three different forms. This is a teaching of the United Pentecostal Church and the United Apostolic Church. T.D. Jakes, if you're familiar with T.D. Jakes, he's a oneness Pentecostal, at least. He was ordained that way. He hasn't denied any of it. He seems to waffle a little bit, but he's never renounced any of those teachings. So without renouncing it, I have a hard time believing that he's Trinitarian at all. So what do we do with these guys? Well, clearly, as I told you, Jesus makes a distinction between himself and God the Father. There's two, right? There's at least two wills in the Garden of Gethsemane, not my will, but thine be done. Jesus clearly makes a distinction between himself and the Spirit in John 14. We'll send another. So the oneness doctrine doesn't jive with the biblical concept, the biblical teaching that there is, that these beings are distinct from one another, even though they're the same. Ultimately, the Trinity solves more problems than it creates. And that's the big thing. Think about this. Is God in need of anything? If God is God, and here's where all of these worldviews fail. If God is God, he is not in need of anything. Would you agree with that? Did he need to create us? Was God lonely, sitting out there in space? No. But God is also love. How can God be love before he creates? Remember we talked about Augustine, the lover, the beloved, and the love that is between us. How does that exist before God creates? If God is a monad, if he's an Islamic type God, there's nothing to love. I guess he could love himself. That's kind of narcissistic in some sense. But that's really not a relational aspect. If God is pantheistic, then his omnipotence fails, because there's at least somebody else that's as strong as you are. And if he's as strong as you are, you can't overtake him. You're not the all-powerful being. You're one of the most powerful beings. But in order to be all-powerful, there has to be nobody that is your equal. But if you have a trinity, if you have a single being where there's an interrelationship within that being, you can show love. You can show agreement. You can do all of those things within yourself that reflect the nature of God without ever having to create. Now, God doesn't need to create. He can be God in all of those attributes. He can be unchanging in that way. And only a triune being can be all-loving from all eternity through the interrelationship of persons. The writer to the book of Hebrews makes a great point when he writes, "When Christ appeared as high priest of the good things that have come then, through the greater and more perfect tent, that not made with hands, that is not of creation, he entered once for all into the holy places." So what the writer of the book of Hebrews is, he's comparing the high priest who goes into the Holy of Holies once a year and applies the blood to get the forgiveness of sins for Israel. And the Hebrew writer of the book of Hebrews is saying, look, that's not good enough. That's just a Band-Aid. It doesn't cure the condition. It just covers the wound for right now. He's saying Christ, as high priest, went into the real heaven, went into the real Holy of Holies, where God the Father dwells. Not made with hands, that is not of this creation, but he entered once for all into the holy places, not by means of blood of goats and calves, but by means of his own blood, thus securing an eternal redemption. For if the blood of goats and bulls and the sprinkling of defiled persons with ashes of a heifer sanctify for purification that flesh, how much more will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without blemish to God? Christ, the Spirit, and God. Purify our conscience from dead works to serve that living God. So Christ, having been offered once to bear the sins of many, will appear a second time, not to deal with sin, but to save those who are eagerly waiting for him. It is key to our salvation that Jesus be able to appear before the real Holy of Holies and offer his blood, not goats and calves. That won't pay the bill. The debt is high. The sin of all humanity, past, present, and future. How do you pay for that? Only the blood of Christ, only the blood of an eternal person. Only the sacrifice of someone who will remain sacrificed in some sense, right? In Revelation, it says that when he looks, that the Lamb appears as it had been slain. So Jesus still bears the marks of his crucifixion in heaven. Paid that debt and bought our redemption. The Trinity is key. It's central. It's the focus of everything we do. And that's why, by the way, you'll all have to change your Christmas decor, because if you know anything about the Council of Nicaea, there was a guy there by the name of St. Nicholas. You all familiar with St. Nicholas? The lovely guy used to give a lot of gifts to children. We put a red suit on him now, but that wasn't necessarily who he was. And there was a guy named Arius who was basically an ancient Jehovah's Witness. I mean, that's the easiest way I can say it. And Arius was saying, no, Jesus was a created being. Jesus was a created being. And he got Nicholas so fired up, he actually walked over and he clocked the guy. Boom! And he had to, they pulled him out. Now, Constantine wasn't thrilled with this. And he said, okay, you time out. Arius, we need to pull you into the dungeon. You know, we gotta calm you down here. But he let him go. Nicholas apologized. But all of you, I want my Santa Claus, to punch heretics. That's the kind of Santa Claus that I like. I don't know how apocryphal that story is. That's the commonly known story about Nicaea. But the piece is it reflects the idea that this is how passionate Christians were. I mean, we're talking 20 years before this, they were in the worst persecution in the history of the church. The Diocletian persecution was nasty. I mean, they were and then Constantine comes, he sees a vision, says, "Olly, olly, oxen free, great. You know, Christianity can be practiced alongside anything else." He holds this ecumenical council. Within 20 years, the Christians are all gathering together, but the idea of the Trinity is so instilled in them, and they're so passionate about it, they feel it's worth fighting for. I think we need to do that a little bit more here. I think we need to understand how big a deal the Trinity is, and not take it as maybe some esoteric doctrine that only theologians talk about, but saying, my salvation depends on the Trinity's being true. Let's pray. Father, we just glorify you again that you have revealed yourself to us in this way. We realize how far we have to reach, Lord, and that we'll never understand all of this, but we pray that you would give us a little bit of help in at least apprehending the basics and walking confidently in knowing that your testimony is true. Will you please bless the rest of our evening and our week ahead? We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.